Good morning, everyone. It is fantastic to see you this morning. I'm glad that you're here. We're about to begin worship, and I would love for you to make your way in, prepare your hearts to hear from God's word. He is our hope and our confidence. And we are going to get started here in just a moment. You got the music back there? There we go. It is great to see everybody here this morning. I hope that you made it early enough, like I did, to have some breakfast in the fellowship hall today. Yeah, if you fall asleep because of our fellowship breakfast this morning, I will try to have a little extra energy today when I preach to help keep you awake. If you didn't make it here at 9 a.m. for our fellowship breakfast, we are still glad that you're here, although we are sad that you missed the really good food that we had. So I want to say welcome. My name is Brent. I'm one of the elders here at New Song and the lead pastor, and it is my joy to welcome you here. If you're a church member, if you're a regular attender, if you're a guest today, I want to say how glad we are that you're here. Many of you know that we've been praying for some folks, especially Libby Wallace has been on our mind. Being in the hospital this week, I'm really glad to see David Dixon right here. I just found out this morning that he's been in the hospital this week, and we're so glad that he is okay and he's able to be here this morning. We're praying for God's help for all those that need physical healing, and if that's you today, and maybe we know about that, maybe we don't, maybe you haven't even told anyone. We are going to trust that God is going to work in that way in your life, and trust through faith that you're going to see that healing. It's good to be together as a church family. We got to hear some amazing testimonies this morning. During the combined small group, I was encouraged and inspired, even as I heard Pat Caddy give her testimony this morning before I left to come in here. About what God is able to do. Nothing is impossible with God was what we heard, right? And we are going to see that today. All right, so prepare your mind and your heart for worship, for what God is going to do by hearing from his word, and as we worship in spirit and in truth together today through music. We're going to open up our worship time with our Old Testament reading. Debbie has that. You have that? I've got it here. You got the mics over there? Okay. Yeah, I think Debbie got unexpectedly pulled back into worship care, even though she was going to do the Old Testament reading. Yeah, yeah.
Come, go, stay, what? Where do we go?
There you go. Psalm 44, 1 through 8.
Yeah, thank you. Hi. Okay. Hi, I'm Debbie Barlow. I'm a member here at New Song. It's my privilege to read Psalm 44, verses 1 through 8. I don't know what page it is, but I know you got this, right, John? 453. Thank you. Page 453 in the church Bible. Psalm 44. We have heard it with our ears, O God. Our ancestors have told us what you did in their days and in days long ago. With your hand, you drove out the nations and planted our ancestors. You crushed the peoples and made our ancestors flourish. It was not by their sword that they won the land, nor did their arm bring them victory. It was your right hand, your arm, and the light of your face. For you loved them. You are my king and my God, who decrees victories for Jacob. Through you we push back our enemies. Through your name we trample our foes. But no trust in my bow. My sword does not bring me victory, but you give us victory over our enemies. You put our adversaries to shame. In God we make our boast all day long, and we will praise your name forever. This is the word of the Lord.
All right, good morning, everybody. Go ahead and stand up And we're going to celebrate that victory that was just spoken about in that passage. So we're excited to be here, excited to worship. You guys got to get louder today since the sugar's kicking in, you know. So I want to hear you.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what a Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Don't He heaven, you conquer the grave, you free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. Been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things.
And I know
you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things.
All right, sing it out. Hallelujah.
And hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
Sing it again, hallelujah.
And hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
Amen, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. My name is Josh Lee. It's a joy to be here. I've been missing church for work, but it's such a joy to be here worshiping Christ with you guys. The passage for New Testament this morning will be 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8 through 19. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others, as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength of God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Dear friends, do not be surprised at this fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice in as much as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the spirit of glory of God rests on you. If you suffer, you should not be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Josh. My name's Greg, and it's a pleasure for me to be able to lead in prayer time here in just a moment. If you were in small group, we talked about anxiety. We all suffer from anxiety from time to time, right? And anxiety as a weapon of the devil can lead to paralysis. You're just so overcome and so burdened that you just feel like you can't even move. It could be a job, it could be finances, it could be relationships, health, it could be anything. The best defense against anxiety is what we're about to do right now. Prayer and scripture. Prayer and scripture. Why? Because both of those things bring us into the presence of Jesus. And you can't be anxious if you're truly in the presence of Jesus. You can be excited, but you won't be anxious. Your fears and worries will melt away. So if you'd like to join me up front here, I encourage you to do that. Come on right now. You can pray where you're seated. You can gather together as a family in groups. Whatever works for you, please join me in this time of prayer. Heavenly Father, our enemy wants us to be anxious. Our enemy wants us to be wrapped up and paralyzed by our worries and our fears. That is not the plan that you have for us. Jesus paid the price with his blood so that we could have confidence, so that we could have courage, so that we could have comfort. Not to be arrogant, Lord, because it's not about us. It's all about you. But you give us the courage and the confidence to stand during a storm in hard times to remind people that the difference is that we have Jesus in our lives. And that's all the difference, Father. I can't do it by myself. I'll crumble. I'll be paralyzed by fear. We all will. But that's not what you call us to, Lord. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the inexplicable love and that you have for us and the grace that you shed on us. We don't deserve it, Lord, but that's the nature of grace, receiving the gift that none of us deserve and how thankful we are for it, Lord. So thank you for this opportunity to come together and pray and worship and open your word and just be in your presence, Father. May the things we say and do be glorifying to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. And just before I dismiss for Children's Church, which I'm going to do in just a second. In fact, if you're working in Children's Church today, feel free to get a head start. I want to be selfish for just a minute. I hope I have enough equity in the bank. Most of you know my son Kyle. He grew up in this church. He's a new father. He's a new husband. Then he became a new father, and he's a new Virginia Beach police officer. He's only been out on the streets for about 3 months. Well, as you all know, first responders and those in uniform see a lot of darkness. And he saw some real darkness this week. And I'll just leave it at that. He was the first officer to respond to a particular scene So I don't want to just stand here and say, please pray for Kyle. I do want that. But pray for all those men and women that wear those uniforms and do the things that they do so that we don't have to. Things that have to be done, but things you and I'll never have to see that they have to see and live with. So just please remember, as I need to remember, to pray for those in uniform. Okay, so I think our children's church workers have probably gone. If you're the ages of K through 3 and you're excited to go to children's church today, you are free to go. Look at that orderly dismissal. All right.
All right, everybody, go ahead and stand up. And we're going to sing Christ is Risen. All right, sing with us. Let no one call it sin remain. going to sing a song called Always. And we realize that our foes are many, but we're going to stand our ground because we've got Jesus. Amen. All right, let's sing.
My foes are many, they may rise against me, but I will hold my ground.
We will not fear.
And I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. My help is on the way. And oh my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. And I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through always, always. Whoa.
Trouble surrounds
me, chaos abounding, my soul will rest in.
Will not fear.
I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way.
My help
is on the way. My refuge and strength always. And I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through always, always. Whoa. I lift my eyes up as my help comes from the Lord.
Let's sing it, church. Where our help comes from.
I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. I lift my eyes up. My help comes from the Lord.
One more time.
And I lift my eyes up. My help comes from the Lord. From you, Lord. From you, Lord. Oh, my God. He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. And I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through always, always. Whoa.
This morning.
Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. It really works out well that the song we just sang starts off, "My foes are many and they rise against me." Because today we come to Mark chapter 6, where Jesus is going to encounter some opposition. I invite you to turn there in your Bibles. Like I said, to Mark chapter 6, we're trying to move very quickly through the Gospel of Mark because Mark's pace of writing and his style is very fast-paced, and it keeps us moving. So I want to try to honor that in preaching through this book, and it's a battle, to be honest, because there are some parts I want to slow down on, and I want to spend a whole week on some of the miracles that Jesus is performing. But if we did that, we would be 4 weeks per chapter, and Mark is just moving faster than that. So I'm trying to keep up. We're going to be in the first half of chapter 6 today, which seems in some ways like a little bit of a letdown, right? I said foes are going to rise against Jesus. We're going to see opposition grow. It's shocking to see that after what we just saw in chapter 5, right? Do you remember Jesus calmed the storm? He cast an army of demons out of a man. He healed a woman from a sickness she had had for years that doctors had not been able to help. And he raised a little girl from the dead. I gave you the analogy that Jesus was turning up the volume on displays of his power and authority, especially in Mark chapter 5. So you would expect Jesus just raised a girl from the dead. You would expect it might move forward and be smooth sailing, that everybody would be getting on board, saying this guy that can calm the sea and can cast out armies of demons and can raise the dead, we're all going to get on board. We want to ride this train. We want to be involved and follow this man, Jesus. But instead, Mark reminds us that there is opposition and people who do not want to see Jesus succeed. It's helpful for me to remember as the disappointment starts to set in about Mark chapter 6, that really every good story deals with opposition, right? We don't have many stories or many movies that are included just somebody goes along and they never have any problems and everything is a bright, sunshiny day, and then the story ends and there is nothing, never anything that happens, right? When you're studying literature, you learn about things like a protagonist and an antagonist and conflict and how tension builds throughout a storyline, right? And oftentimes that tension builds through opposition, through the bad guy, through the evil guy. I mean, you think me and the boys a little while back, we had a subscription to Disney Plus for a little while, and we watched all the Marvel superhero movies. What would a superhero movie be without a bad guy? You know, Thanos snapping his fingers and everything. What's the point if Superman's just running around saving people? I know Superman's not. If you're a Marvel fan, forgive me. If Thor or Iron Man are running around, they don't even have anybody to save because there's no bad guys. You know, it's only like helping ladies cross the street and the bus not hit them. You know, what? That's not an exciting movie. You need tension and you need opposition in order for the story to develop. And actually, Jesus needs opposition for the story to develop because Mark is moving toward the cross, and the cross doesn't happen with people who hate Jesus and want to see him murdered. Chapter 6 is a good reminder of that. Another thing it makes me think of is yesterday we went to NASA Langley Research Center over in Hampton, and they had an open house, and there were thousands of people there. I couldn't believe how many people showed up for that. I thought it might be a couple hundred. I mean, the line was 1,000 people long at each of the satellite parking stations. It was mind-blowing how many people were there. But one of the things that as you take the tour, you go around and you see there's a wind tunnel and a wind tunnel and a wind tunnel, and here's the hypersonic wind tunnel, and here's the large wind tunnel, and here's the small wind tunnel, and now they're building a vertical wind tunnel. And it's like they do all of this so that they can do research. And the reason they do research is because air resistance happens against aircraft. If it wasn't for air resistance, airplanes wouldn't fly. It wouldn't work. The lift that's created by the shape of the wing is what helps an aircraft fly. There's so many different things in life that you need resistance for. I don't know if some of y'all may have seen the it's about a 10-minute video Arnold Schwarzenegger recorded this week talking about strength and shunning hatred. It's not from a Christian perspective, but it's a phenomenal video. I don't know if you've gotten a chance to look at it. And he's directly speaking to people who have found their lives consumed with hatred for one reason or another, different politics or different skin colors or different races. And I think he's specifically dealing with the rise in anti-Semitism that we're seeing. And he's saying, look, it doesn't take a strong person to hate. Anyone can hate, but it takes a strong person to overcome your hate and become a person of love. Now, like I said, he's not speaking from a Christian perspective, but that resonates very well with what the Bible teaches in many places. And he says, you can't get strong until you meet resistance. You don't get strong by lifting no weights. You get stronger by the more weight you put on the bar. And it's a good thing Arnold's talking about this and not me, because I couldn't lift very much right now. I've been, like, the last 2 months after since my eye surgery and everything, like yesterday I walked, I think, over 2, maybe 3 miles through the tour and everything. That's the farthest I've walked since my surgery and everything. So I feel I want to get back outside and I want to do some things, but I've just had to go so slow the last 2 months. And I want to say again, thank you to you guys who have picked up the slack. And I know I've dropped the ball in some different ways and everything. Just I want to say thank you to y'all for bearing with me over the past 2 months while we've walked through this. Y'all have walked through this with me. And huge thank you to my wife, Sarah, for picking up so much of the slack at home and at our house and everything. Like, it's just, it reminds me of so many different things and helps me to sympathize when people are going through really bad health crises as well. Like, I know we have a couple people right now, but these are kinds of oppositions and foes that we face in this life. And at one time or another, all of us are going to come across opposition. For some of you, it's going to be things that are far more scary and difficult than what I can even imagine from the things that I've been through in my life. But we're all going to face it, and Jesus faced it. And one of the things that can be helpful to us is to realize that Jesus also faced opposition. He walked through trials and tribulation. And even the people that should have been closest to him and on his team, they weren't for him. They turned their back on him. He faced denial and betrayal. And the people in power around doing everything they could to stop him. In today's passage, we get to see some of that. And instead of it crushing your hope, here's my prayer this morning, is that it would not discourage you to see that Jesus faced opposition, but it would help you to realize that some of the things that we sang about today are true, that God is going to come through even when the storm is here, even when the foes arise, even when the opposition is there, that God is still with us and that we still have hope. Mark chapter 6, let me read the first few verses here. Jesus left there, Capernaum is where it's talking about, where he's been doing this ministry and mighty acts, raising the girl from the dead, and went to his hometown, which we know is Nazareth, right? Accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. It starts off well. Jesus goes home. It sounds like he's going to have a homecoming and a welcome. And they even invite him to teach in the synagogue. This means he was at least respected, or at least they knew that he was well known enough to receive an invitation to do this. But this is the last time that Jesus, in Mark's gospel, that Jesus goes into a synagogue in any kind of positive sense. Keep that in mind. And many who heard him were amazed. That's what we've heard that a lot, right? So it's good. They're hearing his teacher. They're amazed by his teaching, but they're not amazed in a good way, in the way that people before have been. They have something different to say. Look at what they have to say. Where did this man get these things, they asked. What's this wisdom that has been given him? What are these remarkable miracles he is performing? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor, except in his own town, among his relatives, and in his own home. Jesus' very own family. We saw them try to come take charge of him a couple weeks ago, right? We already know they're a little bit skeptical. But here it says he's not even honored in his own hometown, his own relatives, his own home. We learn a few things about Jesus' family here, that he had sisters, for example. We learn the names of some of his brothers, James, who we believe wrote the book of James that occurs later in your New Testament. We don't know anything about Joseph necessarily, but Judas is very likely the same person who wrote the New Testament book of Jude that comes right before Revelation. So we know that the story changed at some point, but here in Mark chapter 6, his very own family is opposing him and saying, Jesus, we think you've lost it. You can't keep acting like that. You can't keep saying these things. You can't keep doing these things. The people that heard him teach in his own hometown, a prophet is not without honor except in his own hometown, Jesus. You get the picture of like when somebody becomes famous. You heard about this with movie stars or musicians sometimes. Sometimes musicians will actually sing about this in their songs, that they'll have a group of friends and their group of friends are fans and they're cheering them on when they're just starting to get popular and starting to get big. And then their career really launches off and they're moving to Hollywood or moving to Nashville and they've got a new circle of friends and millions of record sales and all kinds of money and everything. And sometimes it can be hard to hold on to those old friendships, right? Because of jealousy or because of lack of understanding or just because of distance and people moving apart. You know, it sounds like a sad thing. Obviously, I'm not famous, so it's not something I've ever had to deal with. But, you know, people that have, it can be a really disappointing thing that people you grew up with were friends for years and everything. You lose some of those friendships and everything. I wonder if there's something like that going on in the people back in Nazareth. We grew up with Jesus. We know him. Who does he think he is? Just because he's got all these people following him around, he's not so special. I mean, we went to third grade together. You know? Like, it's this kind of attitude that he's encountering when he comes back to Nazareth. Even though he's raising people from the dead and calming the storm. The people in Nazareth just don't know how to handle that. His own family doesn't know how to handle it. So he receives opposition. And here's the result of it. While he's there in Nazareth, where he knows people that are sick and have had disabilities for years maybe, he was probably hoping to come home and have a grand homecoming where he could perform all of these miracles and help so many people. But here's what verse 5 says. He could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. He was amazed at their lack of faith. It's amazing that you have Jesus, whose authority has seemed to have no end up until this point in the book of Mark. He's able to do basically anything that he wants. And even sometimes he's doing miracles that he didn't even intend to do when the woman grabs the hem of his garment. And then suddenly he comes home and he wants to do miracles and he's unable to somehow in his own hometown. What is going on here? Well, theologically, it's kind of a tough question, to be honest. God's power is unlimited. He can do anything that he wants, but there seems to be something in Mark's gospel where he talks about the faith that people have for Jesus to practically solve their problems and the power that is possessed by Jesus himself. And here we see when those two things are not coming together, that there's a serious lack of supernatural events happening. It takes both Jesus' power and people's faith in his power in order to see these huge numbers of people being healed and these incredible miracles being performed. So it's at the intersection of Jesus and faith where you see God's power most at work. And when people are just saying, I don't really believe that there's something to this. I don't really believe he can help. I don't really believe he can solve this problem. I don't really believe he can heal. It's not that God's power is somehow diminished, but that intersection of faith and his power is not taking place in what Mark says here, he could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few people and heal them. It's a really dramatic, stunning statement that the Bible makes even. Faith is not something that is exotic. It's not something that's difficult. We've defined faith so far in Mark as practical belief that Jesus can solve a problem. That's all it takes. And the people here in his own hometown didn't even have simple faith. Sometimes those closest to us can be in opposition. Sometimes, and here's some good news, that changes with time. I told you that James and Jude later write books of the New Testament. So there comes a point in the future that Jesus' family, we even hear in 1 Corinthians, it makes it sound like Jesus' entire family eventually become believers and followers of him. There's a church historian named Eusebius who says at the end of the first century that Jude's grandchildren are still a part of the church. So there becomes, out of Jesus' family, a legacy of faith years later. But for now, there is opposition. Sometimes you can run into opposition from those closest to you. And there's good news that there is still hope, that sometimes over time that changes in some pretty dramatic ways. God wins victories in the lives of the people that you love and who may seem like they're living and making decisions in opposition to you at this point. So that's his trip back, his disappointing trip back to Nazareth, right? Next, what happens? Jesus is going to send out the 12, the disciples. Then Jesus went around teaching from village to village. So he's left. That's all there is to Nazareth. What could have been a dramatic homecoming event, now Jesus is going from village to village, calling the 12 to him. He began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over impure spirits. You'll remember that's something that Jesus has been doing himself up until now. And now he's giving that ability to his disciples as they travel. These were his instructions. Take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra shirt. Whenever you enter the house, stay until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, leave that place and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. So Jesus sends out the disciples. This is one of the places where you could start to call them apostles, because the word apostle means one who is sent out. So Jesus is sending them out in groups of two by two, and he tells them to travel very lightly. Do you get that? They could take a staff, but no bread, no bag, no money. Wear sandals, but not an extra shirt, only the shirt that you've got on. I appreciate this packing advice. I just want you to know I like to pack very lightly. Sometimes we have conflict in our house because my wife has the opposite view. She's like, if I might possibly need this, we need to take it. That is the perspective there. I, on the other hand, take the advice of Jesus. Don't even need an extra shirt. I'm going to be in trouble later. No bread, no bag, no bread. See? No bread. Don't take car snacks. I am opposed to car snacks. If you want a snack, ladies, be honest, how many of y'all take car snacks? You are like intentional about, I've got to get my food to bring with me on the car trip. The crumbs are going to get in your car. If you want the snack, then eat it right before you leave, then go drive. It's easy. That's my point. Jesus says, take no bread. Next time I see you taking car snacks, I'm going to be like, you remember what Jesus said? Oh, well, I know. Yeah, kids, I know. You got to pack lots of stuff. And I'll tell you what, if my kids had to depend on me packing the stuff that they needed, they would be in trouble. I'll be honest. So we're glad for moms and all the car snacks and all the things that they pack too. So I'm joking about Jesus and his travel advice to a certain extent, but I hope that helps you remember that what he's telling them is that they should step out in faith. They don't need to provide for their own needs. They need to trust that God is going to provide for their needs every step of the way, every step of their journey. And people are going to offer hospitality. They're going to provide the food that they need. Everything is going to be provided by God through the generosity of the people around them. But he also warns them. And here's where the theme of opposition comes in. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, leave that place and shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. Jesus says you're going to encounter opposition. Even though you're going out with a message of the kingdom of God has come near, even though you're going to go out with authority to cast out demons and heal people who are sick, things that should all be good news to people, even though you go to people with good news, sometimes they are going to reject your offer of help, reject your message, reject even your very presence. If we were going to apply that today, we would say that sometimes we're going to receive opposition by those we evangelize in the culture around us. This should not surprise us. In fact, Josh Lee just read for us this morning where Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 4, told us that we are blessed if we suffer and are treated poorly for the name of Christ. The New Testament is continually reminding believers in Jesus that we may see persecution and hatred come our way because of Jesus himself, to prepare ourselves for it and to know that Jesus' reward is greater. He's telling them, you're going to go out. I'm going to send you out. You're going to have the authority to carry on my ministry and my message. But some people are not going to receive you. And he gives them instructions about what to do there. Sometimes the message that we take will result in opposition. Not only are they going to receive opposition from those closest to them, not only are they going to receive opposition from the people that they're trying to reach with the message, but they're also going to receive opposition from the government and from people in positions of power. And that's the last one that we see today. Beginning in verse 14, King Herod heard about this, for Jesus' name had become well known. Some were saying, John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why miraculous powers are at work in him. Others said, he is Elijah. Still others claimed he is a prophet, like one of the prophets long ago. But when Herod heard this, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised from the dead. So Jesus is receiving opposition from Herod in the same way that John the Baptist had received opposition from Herod and had even lost his life as a result of that. The rest of today's passage is a flashback from verses 17 to 29 about what happened to John the Baptist. In Mark's gospel, we haven't heard about John the Baptist since chapter 1. John went before Jesus, preparing the way, prophesying that one was coming after him. John the Baptist was setting the stage. But then, since then, we haven't heard about John the Baptist. And then today in chapter 6, we find out that he's been killed by Herod. Herod had a convoluted family tree and had killed people in his own family because he was paranoid that they were trying to take his role. He wasn't technically a king. The technical term for his position was called tetrarch. But sometimes the Gospels refer to him just casually, non-technically, as King Herod. And Herod was living in immorality, sexual immorality. He was doing something that was against God's law and against what most anyone would consider to be an ethical relationship, and John had called him out on it. You see that in verse 18, for John had been saying to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. So Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him, but she was not able to because Herod feared John and protected him, knowing him to be a righteous and holy man. When Herod heard John, he was greatly puzzled, yet he liked to listen to him. So there's this conflict, but Herod is intrigued by John, and he doesn't want to see him harmed at this point, just thrown in prison. Finally, the opportune time came on his birthday. Herod gave a banquet for his high officials and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. When the daughter of Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the girl, "Ask me for anything you want, and I'll give it to you." And he promised her with an oath, "Whatever you ask, I will give you up to half my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What shall I ask for?" "The head of John the Baptist," she answered. At once the girl hurried to the king with this request, "I want you to give me right now the head of John the Baptist on a platter," which is a disgusting request. That a girl would think of this on her own is unlikely. Most scholars think that this was a hatched plan and that she's kind of the tool to carry this out. The king was greatly distressed, but because of his oaths and his dinner guests, he did not want to refuse her. So he immediately sent an executioner with orders to bring John's head. The man went, beheaded John in the prison, and brought back his head on a platter. He presented it to the girl, and she gave it to her mother. On hearing this, John's disciples came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. So John the Baptist encountered opposition. And now Jesus is countering opposition from the same political leader that John the Baptist did. The Bible tells us that there will be times when the church is hated by the very government and the earthly powers that reign in certain parts of the world. We see that today in other parts of the world. There are moments when we catch glimpses of it here, but nothing to the degree that our brothers and sisters in Christ have to meet underground and hide their identities, and sometimes are threatened or even harmed or killed because of their faith. There are parts of the world where that is an active and real possibility. Yet our brothers and sisters still remain faithful to Jesus, even to the point of death. What you see here with this kind of opposition could be very disheartening for us. I mean, we just sang a song that God will come through always when foes rise against me, right? We could be tempted to say, well, foes rose against John the Baptist, and it seems like God didn't come through there. And then there's other people. Think about Stephen in the book of Acts, the first Christian martyr. Enemies rose against him. And he died. You mean to tell me that God is going to come through in some way, but it still might end in me not coming through with a victory? I mean, I watch, not real often, but sometimes I'll flip through TV channels and I'll see these pastors of huge churches. And lots of times all that they love to talk about, how God is going to give you your victory today. And you just need to claim it. And you just need to have faith. And God is going to come through. And tomorrow's the day that you're going to see increase. Right? Y'all have heard this kind of stuff too, right? And I just picture John the Baptist back in his jail cell right before this happened, watching on his TV screen. And they're like, "Today's your day of victory." And the guy's coming in with his axe or sword or whatever he used to cut off John's head. What in the world? What good is God's victory if it sometimes ends in what seems to be our defeat? Well, the reality is that God's victory sometimes comes through what outwardly looks like defeat. Because it's not that John the Baptist lost here. We know from the story in the immediately preceding chapter that Jesus has power over death. Remember, he raised the little girl from the dead. So death is not the end. And John the Baptist didn't lose. John the Baptist was faithful to what God called him to do. And even in death, he won a victory. And there are sometimes for us that the obstacles and the foes that are mounted against us are going to seem like they overcome us. But even in the midst of that defeat, we can win victory. Do you know how I know that's true? Because that's exactly what happened to Jesus himself. And Mark, in this chapter, is pointing us forward to Jesus himself going through this. A couple different ways I want to show you that Mark, in the death of John the Baptist, is foreshadowing what Jesus is going to go through in just about 8 or 9 more chapters. You notice that Herod was hesitant to kill John the Baptist, right? Because why? Verse 20, he was a righteous and holy man, which is a description given of Jesus in the Passion narrative. Not only that, verse 26, the king was greatly distressed. Do you remember Pilate and the torment that he went through, trying to not crucify Jesus, but then eventually giving in to the crowds? And he had a dream, and he was torn what to do. He knew Jesus was not guilty. Herod didn't want to kill John the Baptist. And here's one more place. On hearing this, John's disciples took his body and laid it in a tomb. What happened to Jesus after he was on the cross? He was taken, laid in a tomb. Mark is giving us, in some very subtle ways, in this picture of John the Baptist losing to what seems to be outwardly the government authorities able to put him to death. Mark is giving us hints about what is going to happen to Jesus. Because outwardly, it looked like the opponents of Jesus were going to win. It looked like they had succeeded by nailing him to a cross. It looked like Satan's plan had prevailed in killing the Son of God and defeating his plan to rule and bring God's kingdom in on the earth. But what we find out is that it was exactly in the death of Christ that death itself was defeated. Right? Like we just sang earlier, trampling over death by death. It was in dying that Jesus won his greatest victory. It was in what looked like an outward defeat. It looked like it was lost, but it was actually Jesus winning. So our foes rise up. We are so thankful for the many times that God helps us to overcome them. We've got stories. Lots of stories among us. You got to hear some this morning. What incredible testimonies you got to hear today, right? If you were in for our combined small group time. I've got a story from about a month ago when I was starting to lose vision in one of my eyes. And today I can see you on this side of the room over here. I still got a little gas bubble floating around down here in the bottom of my eye. It's still not perfect yet, but it's on its way. Right? We've got stories about God's victories that he's given. And we also have stories that sometimes it looks like the outside and the opponent won. But the hope of the gospel is that even death cannot defeat Jesus. Even when opposition comes, he is still walking with us through this. And what looks like it may be the end is actually his very victory coming through. I believe Mark wants to take this passage and prepare us for rejection and suffering in this life. Jesus is going to suffer and be killed. His disciples are going to suffer. Many of them are going to be martyred. John the Baptist, we see. But you know what has helped us be prepared more than anything for chapter 6? And the fact that foes are going to arise and opposition is going to come, and sometimes even death is going to overtake this life. You know what's prepared us even better for Mark chapter 6 is Mark chapter 5. Is that we've seen the greatness and the glory of Jesus. We know the kind of power that he has. So it doesn't matter, even the greatest powers of this earth and this creation, even death itself, bow before the Lord of all creation. Victory is ours in Christ, no matter what happens to us in this life. So we move forward. We're thankful for every victory that we see, both earthly and heavenly, both when it seems like it's a glorious win and even sometimes when it seems like we walk in outward defeat. We know that Jesus is with us and his power is greater. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for bringing us back to earth in Mark chapter 6. We thank you for these stories of opposition, which could be a discouragement to us. But it's my prayer today that we would know the goodness of your power, and knowing that being in relationship with Jesus is more satisfying than all, more satisfying than healing, more satisfying than victory, more satisfying even than life itself, and that we would give up all of them if we could just know Christ and be found in him, not knowing a righteousness that comes from the law, but a righteousness that is through faith alone in him, that knowing Christ is everything to us, and that in him we have victory no matter what comes our way in this life, no matter how many foes or how large they are or how long they seem to dwell with us, is that we always have your victory day in, day out through faith in him. God, for those that are struggling against foes and enemies of all kinds today, I ask that you would allow them to see even an earthly victory over those. I ask that you would allow them to see relationships restored and financial needs met and sicknesses healed and anxiety relieved. And dreams realized. And families brought back together. I ask that you would allow us to see all of those things and be able to see and testify about the victories that you give. And I also ask that the times that it seems like earthly victories are lost, when families crumble, when cancer has its way, when doctors don't have any other answers about what they can do, that we can know our victory is still fully ours in Jesus. So we give you thanks today for your goodness, for walking with us through the darkest valley and the highest mountains both. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing a closing song as we normally do. And I know we've got some folks that will be in the back. I will be one of them. I see Ron back there as well. If you need prayer for any of the battles that are going on in your life, if you need some victories, come back and let us pray for you about those. If you need to know Jesus for the first time, come back and let us pray with you. Let us let you know how you can meet him and know him for the first time. The rest of us, let's stand together, sing and worship about the God who conquers all and always gives us a victory.
Give you my love.
lay down my life. I take up my cross. Jesus, for you are my God, whatever the cost. Jesus, my heart is yours, take it all, my life in your hands, my heart is yours, take it all. Take it all, my life in your hands, and all to Jesus I surrender, all to you I freely give, and I will ever love and trust you. Jesus, I surrender all to you, I freely give, and I will ever love and trust you in your presence, I will. Take it all, my life in your hands. My heart is yours, take it all, my life in your hands. My heart is yours, take it all. Take it all, my life in your hands. My heart is yours, and take it all, my life in your hands. And take it all, my life in your hands. And you can take it all, my life in your hands.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated just for another minute. Let me give you a couple of announcements before we head out today. Not too many announcements this week. We've just had a lot of stuff happen last week or two. So we don't have too many announcements today. We'll pick up next week with a few more things. But first of all, I want to let you know about Trunk or Treat is coming up this coming Saturday night. Ours is called Trunks of Treats, and we would love for you to sign up and be a part. I know I've seen a number of you already on the sign-up sheet. You can find that at newsong.live/trunk. And so you can sign up to be a part. And at 6 p.m. this coming Saturday night, we'll gather in the parking lot. You can gather a little bit earlier than that if you have things to set up. And you can be ready for the event to begin at 6, and we're going to have a great time out there having trunk or treat, giving candy away to kids, and maybe a few of you can eat a little bit of candy too if you can pretend to be a kid and maybe wear a costume too. So I'm sure some of the adults will have costumes on, right, Michelle? You won't be alone. Anybody else that comes dressed up, love to see you this coming Saturday night. Great time for the kids, but even if you're not a kid or even if you don't have any kids, you can still come and have a great time of fellowship with your church family. We'd love to see you. So that was the main announcement for this week. We have the list of events coming up. There are a couple things on there. This coming Sunday, the kids will have a special event since it's fifth Sunday and almost Reformation Day as well. They have a special kids church next week that'll be all the way K through 6 as well. You see movie night coming up in November, watching the Super Mario Brothers movie. And we'll start talking about Thanksgiving boxes soon for you to be able to donate monies for us to put together money and supplies and all the stuff that we need to put together the boxes to serve families in our community. That'll be coming up in the month of November. So be looking forward to that as well. We wrapped up Operation Christmas Child yesterday with the party. I heard about 120 boxes were packed already, which is fantastic. Thank you all so much for your help with those. And we're glad for that. If you still have a box that you want to bring in, you're still able to do that for the next couple weeks. So go ahead and bring those in, and we'll start working on Thanksgiving boxes soon as well. All right? Everybody good? Thank you so much for being here. My prayer is that you've heard from God's word clearly, that it's been an encouragement to you, and that the Holy Spirit has been at work in your life. And I want to send you out today with God's word itself, 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 10 and 11. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen.
Yeah.
in hard times, in conversations.